messy. And being a little tired. This is my cooking day, the only day I cook. I had company, and the company just left. So I don't know whether you really want me to come or not, do you? I'm Sissy Anderson, Walter Anderson's wife. And you are all from Norway?
I'm over here, Miss Anderson. I'm Daryl Dry, and I just live around here. This friend of mine, there's a good Don Smith. This is James and Melissa. They're doctors with the medical center, and then these are four Norwegian doctors that are here.
And you are all doctors?
Well, she's actually a psychologist. We're the others are doctors.
Ivan Echo.
Almost.
Magnus.
I'm sorry, Magnus.
You better let them say their own.
I'm trying to train with one of these last names. Magnus Home.
This is wonderful for me to see you. Our Scott went to Norway.
That's what we heard.
And his friend had come to Canada before. And long, long years ago, I went to a French lycée and had a very good friend from Norway. They had a lycée. Her name was Tootsie Hine. Are you want to go in and see what's in the cottage?
We would love to.
Let me introduce you. This is Margaret.
Hi. Glad to meet you.
I'm Sissy. That's what they call me.
Sissy. Only Sissy.
This is Anna McGrath. Ivan.
Hello.
And Tom Anderson.
Hello.
Oh, we're so glad to meet.
But Shelly came to get me, and at first I said, no, I can't. And then I came. Was his little private sanctuary, which he kept locked. We had never seen it until after his death. And as we look out of the windows, I think you'll be able to see out of the windows, we see all of this. And most of it is something that he planted here himself. For instance, the big-leaved magnolia, which is a prehistoric tree and never grows on the coast. And he brought them down from the Pascagoula River swamps and planted them here. And when you look out of the window, you get this strong feeling that the outside is part of the inside, which is nice. And that's his boat. That's his little boat in which he traveled to Horn Island.
Paying attention to me.
I didn't know for a minute whether those were somebody's shoes or leaves off the magnolia. And he always slept there. Didn't matter how cold it got, he was right there. And he did a great deal of his work out here. I don't believe he painted on this porch. He would be apt to go through to the back to do his painting because the light is from the north. But he carved most of his wood carvings out on this porch. He did a great deal of his pottery decorating. And as you can see, we haven't very many wood carvings left, but we have the swimmer, which is one of the bigger ones. And it was made from the limb of an oak tree, which grew right out here. It was one of his favorite trees. He lost it, unfortunately, in one of our good hurricanes, which occurred in 1947. And so he kept the pieces of it, the different parts. And you can almost see the way the limb of the tree grew as you look at the figure of the swimmer. The little deer, I think, the two pictures on the little stool there are pictures of a large group sculpture that he did. And that stood right out in his yard for many years. The central figure looks as if it had antlers on its head, but I think they really represent the tributaries of the river. And then the various flora and fauna that were apt to be around the river, he carved carefully and placed there. The central figure is gone. We don't know what became of it. Probably just disintegrated in this climate, which is a very damp, humid climate, and things don't last too well. On the table at the other end, you will see a group of pottery figures, even a few little bowls and things, which he was working on. And they were left just like that. They have never been fired. And it's rather remarkable that they've lasted as well as they have. But some of them have crumbled a little bit, but they've been through bad weather and good. The boat underneath the table there with the Greek warriors and was a boat which he made for his children when they were little. They were reading aloud from the Odyssey. And he always liked to bring things alive for children. And so he made his boat for them. The figures are like puppets. They can be lifted out. There's a little slot they go into. And they had at one time their legs, which could be put onto them. So it was a very exciting sort of toy for children, and they had a lot of fun with it. The bicycle is his old bicycle. He was a person who didn't like motors. He never liked motors. And most of his traveling around was done on that bicycle. He rode it up to New York City at one time. He rode it down to the Florida Keys. And he rode it all the way across Texas. Quite a trip. And he never liked a motor in his boat. He always either rode or rigged up a little sail and sailed. Have you any questions?
How long did this oak swimmer carve it take?
How long did it take? I'm afraid I can't answer that.
When he would start something like that, would he finish it, just stay with it until he went through it, or would he do a little?
He would stay with it for a long time, but as a student at the Pennsylvania Academy, he did a lot of carving, with which he paid for a lot of his tuition books and so forth. He had cut the tendons in his right hand, and he could never after that use a gouge of You know, the way they use a wood carving tool. And he couldn't use that. So he carved that with a little hatchet and a wood rasp. And he could move very quickly with both those tools. He would hack. I've never seen anything like it.
And rasping.
And then suddenly, there it would be. Rough, more or less.
I don't think I've ever seen any kind of carving that big in oak. That's just under steel. I mean, slightly softer than
iron. It's like doing iron, really.
It really is.
Of course, that's not live oak. Live oak is more, it's water oak. It was a water oak tree. Anybody else? Isn't it a lovely place to be?
It really is.
Always birds. They're always here. Now, would you like to go inside? Shelley, I've got a feeling we'll have to turn on that light. You have to excuse the inside because we have just brought a show back from Memphis, Tennessee. And a great deal of that show is stacked up in here. It hasn't been put away yet. Chimney in the middle, a little fireplace in each little room, and each little room only had one window. And when we moved into it, he just immediately said, this won't do at all. There's no light, it's dark. And so he started. The first thing he did was to take out the central partition and take out the chimney. Build himself a new chimney. Then it still wasn't light enough. It was big and airy, sort of, but that's all. So then he took out the end and put windows in. Then he took out this door right here and put mostly glass there. It's an old garage door, as a matter of fact. So is that one. Then he cut that all out. In the meantime, he built everything in that he wanted, the little bunks and the little window seat and little cabinets, and made all his own furniture. This is his main chair, which was in the form of a pelican. Can you see our pelican?
Can you see it?
Here's his wing. Down like this.
Yeah.
There's his head,
yeah.
His big old beak. Here's his tail. And there's his. And actually, it's a very comfortable chair. He did well. The table, if you look at it, you'll see the blue jays. Hear them outside and see them inside. The legs of it are blue jays. He loved to do little things like that. Somebody's been in here and removed that self-portrait which I had sitting up. It's a watercolor self-portrait.
Someone has put the Biloxi Beach panel.
Well, I moved the Biloxi Beach panel when I was in here yesterday because we couldn't get out there. The plastic mask on the wall is a life mask of him, of his face. Yeah. And the big thing in the corner that looks like a ruler is the Mississippi River marker that they used in the old steamboat days. He found it out on the islands. And you think of Mark Twain, Well, you see the two of twain there, and all the other marks which tell how deep the sandbar was and whether the steamboats could get over it or not. He loved that thing. Found it out on the chandelier. That was his lamp. It had a little sort of hanging thing, was his reading lamp. All the pottery that you see, and all the paintings and drawings, the things that he did at various times. The children are eating watermelon in that little painting right there. And the hangings on the walls are the old rugs which used to be on the floor. We had to put them up because too many people got to going through. But he hooked those rugs himself. He not only did the designs, but he did the hooking. Some of these plates and pots are done in what we call slip, which is colored clay itself. The big pot on the cabinet over there represents Horn Island. The things that people do, like they caught a large sea turtle, and that was probably done in the late 20s. What have I skipped, Shelley? Anybody got any questions? Got this in? If you would like to step out there, it's rather interesting to see the things that he collected. He had a tremendous feeling for form, and wherever he would find a thing that had particular beauty of form, he would bring it in from the islands. And actually, there is the skull of an alligator with its teeth, the skull of a sea turtle, and of a wild boar. All of the various drift on the island with which he did his drift. And you will also see a number of the silk screens that we are now using to make the drifts. If you step into the bathroom, there's a light right inside the door. And if you turn it on, you can see the fading murals over the tub. They are very interesting to me because when I look at them, I always think of prehistoric cave paintings. And when he went to France as a student, he walked across France to the Pyrenees and spent most of his time in the caves at Les Aisy, looking at these beautiful cave paintings and being inspired by them, as he was by all art, wherever he found it. I'm so happy that you came. Was red and black, and the bricks were red. The black bricks had been fired in the kiln, and he found after a very short while that he could not live with red and black like that. And so, where's the psychologist? Anyway, he painted it white, and then painted the black bricks red. I mean, and he got along.
The bench
I love, and it's very comfortable. carved it out so it was a place for your seat. Now, our little painted room is right through here. And he kept it locked. There was a padlock on this outside, and there was also a padlock on the inside. So that if he was gone, he locked it up. If he was inside, he locked it up too. In other words, it was a sort of secret place. And perhaps you'll see why. After he died, we never found the key. So finally, we broke the padlock off and came in. It is hard to see with only this much light. But I'm going to let you look for a minute so that you get the true color.
Did someone the bulbs?
Then I'll turn on the light.
Oh, okay.
The what?
I was taking care of the light switch.
The door is part of the side, so we have to close it. Now tell me, do you want the light on? You can see it a little better. When we came in, I had my sister with me. And you see where there's no paint on the floor? Well, there's a reason for that. He had junk, things that he had beachcombed from the island. Everything that you can imagine. Old tackle boxes, old coolers, old flowering lights, you name it, he had found it on that island. Was piled almost up to the ceiling. And when I came in, I just looked at that and that's all I saw. Didn't see any paintings or anything. But behind me, I heard my sister say, creation at sunrise in this absolutely awed voice, you know, and I turned around. And then I saw that she was looking up over that window. At the rooster crowing for the sunrise. For a long time we used that as a tool for the little room. But we found in here a copy of the 104th Psalm. It was very carefully written out in his handwriting from the King James Version of the Bible. It is the psalm in which the psalmist says, that the Lord puts on light as a garment. And then we took another look around and we saw that he was painting light in all its forms, all the way around the top of the room. And if you look, you will see that this is dawn. This is the east wall. The sun does rise here. And the rooster crows for that sunrise. You go around through the morning, even the light of a little storm, squall over the water, and then at high noon, this is the south wall, you get the big cumulus clouds that we have so often in the summer particularly. And as you go around, there's afternoon, the slanting light, and a flight of ibis. The ibis are turning to the fly, and you see their black backs and their white bellies. It's a lovely sort of form. And then around here to the west wall, where the sunset is. And finally, here, and he had quite a, he really had a problem when he got to this, because this was the outside chimney, and it had nothing but bricks. This is when he made the plaster and tried to cover it and to paint on it, probably using fresco. And we believe that this is another version of the Mississippi River because it has so many similarities and it divides the east from the west. The tributaries on the head are the same. The flora and fauna are very much the same. But this figure is a girl. I think it probably represents his daughters. And on this end, there's a Turk's cap lily and a wild turkey and an oak leaf. On that end, there's some roadrunners and some cactus. You can see the east-west connotation. The psalmist, no, I should tell you about moths first. This is the Noah and night, but he did not make night in any ordinary way. He took all of the moths that we have here on the coast that fly at night, and we have some very, very beautiful ones. The Cecropia is probably our biggest. There it is. The Polyphemus Sphinx. All the different moths appear on that wall to say it's night. And we wouldn't be out if it wasn't. The psalmist goes on to praise the Lord and to thank him for all the creatures of the earth. And many, many of them. And he goes on to put the creatures of the coast. You can see the little goats on the hillside, the sandhill cranes with their red crests, the little possum. Just, well, you find something new all the time. The alligator is basking in the sunlight at noon. A little deer is coming down to drink in the afternoon, late afternoon. The black skimmers are feeding at sunset. And as you look around, you'll probably find all sorts of things. But it's hard to see them in this light, I think. But they're there. So, that's his little room. He put a medallion around the light up there, just as the people used to put plaster medallions around their old chandelier. And that, I could not decide what that was for the longest time. I would look up there and I'd say, what is that? Is that the sun? No. Flames? No. Clouds? No. And finally, I found in his papers a little verse that he had written. And it was about his favorite flower. It begins, O zinnias. And then when you look up, you can see that it's a zinnia. And when you're looking up, most people will slide their eyes over into that corner. And very often there'll be exclamations, oh, look, he didn't finish. And which I believe is true. I don't think he did finish. But there are people who will argue with me like anything about that. They will say, oh, yes, he did finish. In my religion, if you complete a circle, it means death. And a square is nothing but a circle with the corners pulled out. So some think that he did finish. Others will say there's only one perfection, and that is God. So of course he couldn't quite make it complete. Anyway, there are many different ways of thinking about it. The door, when you open it and come in, you all have had coming in because it was so dark. But people will stand in this door and they will say, oh, Egypt. I didn't know what they meant by that, but I found out. There's a little room in a tomb. It's an anteroom to a tomb in the Valley of the Nobles, which goes off the Valley of the Kings in Egypt, which is exactly like this. Now that seems impossible, incredible, but they say it's true. More than one person has told me this. In the Valley of the Kings, of course, everything is very stylized. The wall paintings are very precise. But in the Valley of the Nobles, they say, they're much more like this, very naturalistic. And so it makes you think, gives you a wonderful thought. Here we are. Art transcends both time and space. This is a man working in the 1950s in Ocean Springs, Mississippi. The other little room is done by a man working probably in around 1800 BC in Egypt. How does that happen? He never been to Egypt. Just the way you want to, because nobody really knows.
Were there a lot of his paintings in that room that you weren't aware of that were found after his death, other than?
There was a carved chest which he had made in that room, right in front of where the alligator is. And when we opened the lid of that chest, there were in it three piles of watercolor paintings.
He's alive, or even after his death, did you?
And I had a pretty good foundation of knowledge of that kind of thing, so that I knew pretty well what this was. And I can remember coming in after he died and not weeping or thinking anything sad, but just thinking to myself, why, this is the most marvelous thing I've ever seen in my life. Here's practically the whole of one artist's right here, not scattered or anything. And I thought to myself at that time, this should be preserved exactly as it is, and never allowed to get away. Well, very little of it has gotten away. It's all still there.
Tell them about the watercolors that were in that room.
In the little painted room, there was a carved wooden chest which he had made, a very nice little chest. And when we lifted the cover and looked in, there were three piles of watercolors, very carefully arranged, fitted into the chest. So they must have been particular ones that he liked.
There were around 1,500 of his watercolors.
I'm just guessing at that.
But in good condition and still.
What?
In good condition and still.
Perfect condition. Perfect condition. And I suppose all artists do. When he would get to work and destroy certain parts of his work, and just before he died, very, very shortly before, he had had one of those periods, and he had burned a great many things. After I took him to the hospital, my sister came into his house, and she found in the fireplace a st- stack about so high of paintings, watercolors. Apparently, he had put them on the fire like that, and they were thick and heavy, and they put out the fire. They hadn't burned. So she took them out of the fireplace, of course, put them away. We still have those paintings. And it's almost impossible to say to yourself now, why did he destroy this beautiful thing? Of course, it didn't get destroyed, but he intended to destroy it. Makes you wonder. I was just talking. I had this young artist who works here now, Stig Markison. And he needed to talk about art, so he was talking to me. And I said that to him. And he said, I do that. So it makes me think that it probably is something in it that is not satisfying to the artist. And so they just destroy it. Strange. When it's sitting down, it's not fair. Anybody wants it on the bed, help yourself.